impressed by his deft approach to diplomacy, and I'm sure that tonight you will find the same thing to be true as you hear his stories from his posts around the world. In particular, we had the occasion to work together on the situation in Darfur, where he helped to pave the way for the largest peacekeeping force around the world that helped bring peace and stability to the people of Darfur. He has an important perspective on U.S. foreign policy, and right now I think his voice is more important than ever before. There's so many pressing global issues that are at the forefront of the agenda, and in particular in our presidential campaign season, at the forefront of our minds as well. And so we're looking forward to having the opportunity to talk with you a little bit further about those issues. I thought we could start out with a little bit about his childhood in Afghanistan. Ambassador Khalilzad talks in his book about the difficulties that he experienced during his childhood there, but also some of the unique experiences and rich history that he encountered in Afghanistan. You talk in the book about some of the difficulties that your family experienced. Your mom had 7 children, but also lost 6 along the way, and so you saw that heartache firsthand. But you also took a lot of inspiration from your mom, and you wrote about how she inspected your homework every night, putting a big emphasis on education, even though she couldn't read herself. I thought you could start us off this evening by telling us a little bit about some of the memories of your childhood in Afghanistan that stand out to you the most as you look back.
First of all, thank you very much. I want to thank the Nixon Foundation and the library for inviting me, and thank you, John, and thanks to you for playing the role that you are playing tonight. Of course, it's only in America that you can be born in a remote part of the world, Afghanistan in my case, and then come to the United States as a legal immigrant. and to be given the opportunities that I was given to succeed. America has been very good to me, and it has been my honor to pay back and to represent the United States in places like Afghanistan, Iraq, and the UN. Regarding Afghanistan, it is an ancient land. It was a center of civilization at one point in the history of the world. It has produced great poets, scientists. My wife Cheryl is here. She is very interested in Rumi. And Rumi was born not far from where I was born. And there is a lesson for us all, for the United States too, that unless you are attentive, and you change and adapt, and you innovate, and you compete, you cannot take your greatness for granted. You can be great at one point, and then you can be in a very different situation. And when I was born in Afghanistan, that part of Afghanistan was not in great shape. It was peaceful. The kind of security problems now in Afghanistan did not exist at that time. But it was a very poor country. As you said, my mother had 13 children. She was married when she was perhaps around 12, 13 years old. She had her first child when she was 15. I remember the death of one of my sisters. She had probably appendicitis, but there were no doctor that could see her. Only somebody who worked in a pharmacy, a pharmacist, was available medical expert to come to see her. I still remember her cries of pain. But on the other hand, we had a great New Year celebration. The Afghans, like the Iranians and some other peoples of that region, celebrate New Year on March 21st, the first day of spring, Nowruz, if there are any people with background in that region. There were happy times, too. But I spent most of my life in northern Afghanistan as a kid. Then I moved to Kabul, which was a more developed place, the most cosmopolitan place. Mazar had 50,000 people. Kabul had 500,000 people at that time. Within a couple of years of that move to Kabul, I came to the United States and I tell that story of my journey from Afghanistan to the U.S. and my first impressions in detail in the book. But it was for a country bumpkin, as I was seen by people in Kabul when I arrived there, wearing one of these caracol hats that President Karzai made it kind of famous around the world, not such modern clothing as the kids of Kabul that soon be on my way to New York. It was a huge cultural shock, and life has not been the same ever since.
So you first came to America as a high school student. You
right.
were awarded a scholarship to
right.
come and study abroad,
right.
and you landed in metropolitan Central Valley, California.
Right.
In a town with one grocery store, one post office, maybe
right.
one stop sign.
Sure.
And it seemed like the people of California made a big impression on you
right.
and helped to sort of form your sense of what America was like. You
sure.
said you never felt like an outsider.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, California changed the world, my world, First, America, I had come through New York, showed how different, backward, how undeveloped, how poor we were in Afghanistan. That was the first shock, flying over New York with an evening flight and looking down and looking at all the lights. It was just unbelievable. We only used to have lights strung on the top of the streets on the poles for the Independence Day celebration in a small part of Kabul. That was the custom or the tradition. We thought they must have a huge party going to see all the lights that we saw. But then coming to California and living in Ceres with a family that was very kindly had taken me as one of their own. I called the father dad, the mother mom. There was two boys who lived at home, Mark and David, they embraced me, and they wanted someone different from a different region of the world, because these students that were brought in were from all over the world, and they wanted someone from far away, so to speak, unfamiliar, and they got one from Afghanistan. But I immediately was shocked by the differences, especially in how men and women related to each other, the husband and wife, what the father did around the house, the relationship between the children and the parents, the discussion around the dinner table, the type of issues that was being discussed, then the relationship with others in the community, existence of so many associations, to go to the Lions Club, to the Rotary Club, to the church group, to the PTA, to on and on, and how the society was organized, very different, where in the case of Afghanistan, it was far more authoritarian, male-dominated, not at least in the circles that that I was a part of or my family were a part of, not kind of a relatively equal discussion and deliberation, much more of an authoritarian kind of structure to the discussions around the table.
And years later, you came back to the United States and you were a student at the University of Chicago, and then you went on to work for the U.S. government in a planning capacity at the State Department and the Defense Department. And I think we'd all be interested to hear a little bit more of your unique perspective about the years that led up to 9/11 and the things that the U.S. government missed.
Sure. Well, first, sometimes you can plan and get ready for things, and that matters, obviously, the most. But sometimes accidents and some event that you do not expect, you hadn't planned for, can have a big effect on your life. And in my case, the University of Chicago, by accident attending a class taught by Professor Albert Wallstetter, was one of our great nuclear strategists. For those of you who are old enough would remember the Cold War, where the kind of Soviet-American rivalry was the defining issue, and the fear of relations escalating to a war and the possibility of use of nuclear weapons was obviously the biggest national security issue facing the United States and the world. And how do you deter a nuclear war? The issues of deterrence were very important. So I had planned to study comparative politics and political philosophy. I ended up working with Professor Wallstetter on nuclear strategy issues. And then when I finished my doctorate at the University of Chicago, I was offered a teaching position at Columbia University in New York. And the Council on Foreign Relations, which is one of our respected institutions in New York, takes young academics and gives them a stipend, their salaries, and offers them to different government agencies as a freebie in terms of cost, but as a someone that they could use usefully to help in their work. And with the logic that the government would benefit from an outside perspective of a young and up-and-coming academic, and the young and academic would learn about how policy is made, how the real world works, while you may be book smart, but now you will see what the real world is like. And so I was in the mid-80s, I went to the Pentagon initially, and then I was traded, as I was told by my boss at the State Department, to the policy planning shop to help with our policy on Afghanistan and the Iran-Iraq war. Although my training had been all on nuclear strategy issues, I couldn't escape my origin, so to speak. They said, we have a lot of people who know nuclear issues, we need someone to help with Afghanistan and Iran and Iraq, so I did that.
And you still had personal connections with leaders in Afghanistan that I'm sure came in handy at that point as well.
I developed it during that period, which came handy after 9/11. So when I was dealing with the Soviet forces who were present in Afghanistan and we were opposing those forces, one of the lessons that I think the question wanted to lead to is that we had assumed that the Soviets would ultimately prevail in Afghanistan. It was a reasonable assumption given the size of the Soviet Union, the size of Afghanistan, and given the pattern of Soviet operations. When a country went pro-Soviet, there was a Brezhnev doctrine and so forth. It was a one-way street. Once you joined it, you were not allowed to leave. And so our strategy was how to make it expensive for them to consume Afghanistan. Lo and behold, the Soviets turned out to be weaker than we thought, and the Afghans persisted and fought harder than we anticipated. The Soviet withdrew. And one of the mistakes that we made at that time, in my view, is that we too disengaged from Afghanistan. And we didn't try to help the Afghans put a government together and help with the reconstruction. After a huge project in which Afghans lost 1 million people, it was a big victory for us, the United States. Our adversary was defeated, and the Afghan problem added to the Soviet problems that were caused by their other mistakes, including the kind of economic and security policies they were following, and contributed perhaps to the destruction of the Soviet Union. So it was a great success for the United States. But by disengaging, in the vacuum of our disengagement came regional powers, pulling Afghanistan apart, and a civil war took place that ultimately resulted in the Taliban takeover and with Al-Qaeda. Taliban coalition or alliance, and ultimately produced 9/11. And then we went back. And so my experience in the 1980s did have a significant impact on what I did. And how I got to, as I describe it in the book, that in the I left at the end of the Reagan administration, the State Department, and in fact came to California, worked for the RAND Corporation in Santa Monica, and also taught at the University of Southern California, California in La Jolla, that then I was invited to come back to government under President Bush. Secretary Cheney, Secretary of Defense, asked me to come and take over the planning shop in the Defense Department, and when finally the results of the Gore versus Bush election became announced, if you remember, it went through courts. I was asked to go and take over the Defense Department as the head of the transition from Clinton to Bush. And I helped Secretary Rumsfeld get confirmed, and then I moved over to the White House to be a special assistant to the president. And when 9/11 happened, and Afghanistan became and front and center as to what to do, and then my background.
They had an in-house expert.
The in-house expert, and I then got involved in Afghanistan. Sorry about the long kind of answer to this, but that gives you the background of why I then became as involved as I did as presidential envoy and then ambassador.
And in the book, you talk about the need for a forward-looking approach to a country that was obviously going to be in transition at the end of the Soviet rule. And you said to one of your colleagues that this was important, and he said to you, you don't know the Soviets.
Right.
They're not going to give up in Afghanistan.
Sure.
And you said, you don't know the Afghans.
Right. Sure. Absolutely. This was during the 80s when I mentioned earlier to you that many people made the assumption, which didn't seem unreasonable, that the Soviets would prevail. I had intellectually, perhaps emotionally too, without perhaps recognizing it, thought it was inappropriate, maybe wrong-headed, to assume at the beginning of a very complex set of circumstances that one knows exactly what the outcome will be. And that, but as you said correctly, many of our smartest experts, and some of them are my good friends, were Soviet experts based on their in-depth study and knowledge of the Soviet Union, assumed that Afghanistan was finished. And when I was raising in terms of what we were doing and at that time and what the effect would be on a post-Soviet Afghanistan, not surprisingly, some argued that I was wasting my time because there would be no post-Soviet Afghanistan, as the Soviets were going to do what was necessary, as their history had demonstrated in dealing with other satellite states that had become part of the Soviet empire, that the Soviet would not allow Afghanistan to leave the empire. And so the goal has to be how to increase the cost to them. And I think one of the lessons that I have learned and lessons that there is important is be careful about what you assume at the beginning about some complex process, how it might end. There may be alternative outcomes rather than a single point outcome that you can be confident of. And two, if your assumptions turn out to be incorrect and you see indicators of that you may be not heading in the direction you thought, you should be able to adjust in time. And governments, especially big bureaucracies, have a hard time adjusting on the dime, so to speak, adjusting quickly. And I think that's the challenge we faced even when we became convinced that the Soviets were going to leave. To adjust policy was hard, other than just to disengage, and the disengagement caused a set of circumstances that ultimately produced 9/11.
Then years later, you returned to Kabul as the presidential envoy and ambassador, and I'm going to read a paragraph from the book, which you can get your signed copy afterwards and read more yourself, but this is a particularly powerful paragraph about your return. As the CIA plane descended, I caught my first glimpse of Kabul International Airport. It looked nothing like the small, pleasant hub it had been when I'd left. Now it resembled a scrapyard. Surrounding the narrow landing strip was a wasteland of mines, broken tanks, armored vehicles, and airplane shells, casualties of an unrelenting war. We hit the tarmac with a thud and taxied across the runway. As the door of the jet opened, I took in the air of Afghanistan for the first time in 30 years. So this was 2002. Talk to us a little bit about what you experienced in that moment and in the months that followed.
Well, it was a truly a shocking experience. I had obviously followed the news of the problems of Afghanistan, of the suffering of Afghans, of the various conflicts that they had gone through. And I tried to do what I could with that when I was not in the government to help from outside. But I was not prepared for the level of destruction and despair and the toll that these years of conflict had taken on the city and on the population. I remember driving through the streets of Kabul, wanting to go to look at my school and the house where I lived before I left Afghanistan. And first the streets were largely empty, hardly any cars on the roads. The shops looked empty. A lot of people that you saw were on bicycles with ashen faces. Didn't see any women on the street. The few that you saw had this, what's called a chadari, this cover they wore. And so many buildings, one after the other, destroyed or seriously damaged. I went to my school, the Ghazi High School, and some walls only stood of this school that used to accommodate some 3,000 students. And I was shocked and concerned, shocked because of what I saw, concerned as to what we had taken on. Because the goal that we had embraced after 9/11 was that we weren't going to abandon Afghanistan again. The president said we made a mistake after the Soviet withdrawal. We were not going to repeat that. And two, we were not going to allow Afghanistan to become, again, a place from which terrorists could attack the United States. No terrorist sanctuary would be allowed in Afghanistan. And were we going to police Afghanistan to prevent that from occurring, or were we going to help the Afghans to police their own territory? Both daunting challenges. And so it was truly a shocking 48 hours before I began to strategize and start sending cables as to what it is that I was witnessing and what the implications of what we were trying to do would be for us and for what we needed to do in Afghanistan.
Part of the reason that those early months and years were marked with success was the personal nature of the relationships that you built with your Afghan counterparts and the coalitions that you built. Talk a little bit about Karzai and about that relationship.
Sure. The Afghans expected a lot from the United States because of what had happened in the 1980s. There was a large program of assistance, and then they felt we had abandoned them. We became disappointed in them because rather than coming together in the aftermath of a great victory that they had achieved against the Soviet Union, they fell apart and fought each other. And now the United States was back. And for many Afghans, there was hope. And there was the opportunity that their country could become normal again, but they feared that the U.S. might abandon them again. So rather than fearing domination or occupation, the primary question I was being asked was, are you going to stay, or are you going to not abandon us again? And because of the destruction that had occurred, not only in terms of the physical structure that I talked about, but also the toll it had taken on the human capital of Afghanistan, and the fact that they had very little resources, I think the central bank did not have more than $25 million in a country of 30 million people. There was no cell phones. I had to take satellite phones with me to distribute, to connect the government, the new government, with the international community. What they wanted was for the U.S. to fix their problems. And we were trying to say, you need to fix your problem, but we will help you. And President Karzai, who I had began to know initially in the 1980s when I worked for the U.S. government at the State Department, had been selected in Bonn to be the leader of Afghanistan. And he was a very charming person, very articulate, nationalistic, a huge improvement over his predecessor as the leader of Afghanistan, this gentleman called Mullah Omar, the one-eyed cleric that not many people had seen before. And here was a very gracious, charming, English-speaking, articulate person that had been selected. But he wanted a deal with the United States that he will, on behalf of his country, give us what we need, which he thought was access to any and all of Afghanistan's territory for the short term, for the long term. But in exchange, the U.S. needs to rebuild Afghanistan. Can we make a deal, he would always argue with me. I said, I'm not in a position, Mr. President, to make such a deal. We want you to lead, and we will help you. Karzai, like many other leaders of that region, I think you have to think of them in their different phases. I talk about in my book about Karzai 1, Karzai 2, Maliki 1, Maliki 2 in the case of Iraq. Under some circumstances, especially at the beginning in Afghanistan, they are the closest of friends. We work well together. But under a different set of circumstances, when they believe they can't count on us, that we're their agenda and our agenda is not the same, that they become disillusioned, angry, and hostile because they had some set of expectations that we, based on their calculation, we did not deliver, then that charming, the best possible leader, becomes a pain in the neck. He's regarded as not capable of delivering, the kind of partner that we had in mind. And I experienced, observed it because I didn't experience it directly because in my period it was Karzai 1 and in Iraq it was Maliki 1. I had the good Karzai and the good Maliki. But my successors in both cases had more difficult partners to deal with. And the book talks about why that change occurred, what we did that was problematic, what they did that was problematic, and what the circumstances was or circumstances were that changed their behavior, although they were the same people. The same individuals, but their policies and their behavior changed because of the circumstances and what we did and what we didn't do and what happened.
And you write in the book, too, about Iraq and how some of the things that went right in Afghanistan in terms of coordination and confidence building among partners were some of the very same things that went wrong in Iraq, particularly with regard to de-Ba'athification and those sorts of things. We can talk more about that in the questions because we want to get to your questions as well, but maybe we could take a minute and you could step back and tell us, you've been at the forefront of these war zones. You've seen these issues also from the vantage point of the United Nations, and you have still a sort of optimistic sense of what the United States could be in the world, which is sort of a rarity these days. And when you were in the planning phase of your career, when you were working at the State Department and the Defense Department, you wrote a memo where you outlined a plan for a strategy of American leadership designed to preserve peace among the major world powers and galvanize collective action among allies as challenges arise.
Right.
Which feels like it's a bit lacking these days. So maybe you could tell us a little bit about what you think the grand strategy for American foreign policy should look like now, in light of these challenges, in light of the difficulties of nation building. What would you put a priority on in our foreign policy?
Well, thank you for that. First, some of the problems we faced in Iraq, whatever you think of, whether we should have invaded or not, were the result of mistakes we made after we went in. I think the dissolving the Iraqi army, going from liberation to occupation, not only the de-Ba'athification, but then the implementation of the de-Ba'athification through a political committee rather than through a judicial process as to who had committed what crime, all of that, and besides not having enough forces, that if you dissolve the local security apparatus, that not wanting to have enough forces to establish order or maintain security, were a combination of factors that together didn't add up. And so I give very poor grades to our performance right after. I also give poor grade to the way we left and disengaged. So we will have a chance perhaps to talk more details of, about Iraq, why things happened or why something didn't happen. With regard to the grand strategy, of course, there is a lot that goes on . How do we prioritize what to do, what not to do? You need a filter. And what is the filter? Filter should come from the decision about what it is that our objectives are, what is our strategy for pursuing those objectives, and the plans and the tasks. You know, I've been a military planner too, so that follow from that rigorous an exercise. And when you don't have a grand strategy, you tend to be reactive. When you have a strategy, you tend to be shaping, because you know what you want, so you try to put things in place, and that provides a helpful tool for advancing your interests. During the Cold War, we had a grand strategy. How do we contain the Soviet Union? A very clear filter. Those who were with us in the Cold War were our friends. We were going to help them, regardless of how badly they treated their people or not. And those who were with the Soviet Union, regardless of how good they were or not, otherwise, they were not on our side. But in the post-Cold War, in a more complex world, we have had a hard time coming with a grand strategy to guide us. And we have had periods of great exertion and followed by periods of great withdrawal. And, you know, post 9/11, there was huge exertion, you know, invading two countries and being extremely active. And now we're in a period of kind of withdrawal. And some of the things that are associated with the period of exertion are in disrepute. For example, well, we should never do nation and state building, and we should do state and nation building at home. I mean, this is President Obama says it, Mr. Trump says it, and I'm sure that Bernie for sure says it, and perhaps even Hillary Clinton, Secretary Clinton, may have said it, but I can't quite be sure about her saying it. But I am sure about the other three who have said it. This is a reaction, a learning or overlearning from what we just did in the decade earlier in Afghanistan and Iraq. I do believe that the United States, as the most powerful country in the world, we still are with all our problems, and we have lots of problems. I mean, we have debts that is growing, economy is sluggish, and domestic needs are rising. Soon the debt could reach a level where, plus our domestic expenses, may not leave much resources for national security. A world is that becoming dangerous. People that we have helped are not necessarily grateful. Our allies are not doing enough to carry the burden. But nevertheless, with all of this and more, I could go on. The United States is the preeminent world power. China is rising, sure. But it's number two still. So if we had a strategy, a plan, which I advocate we should, and I have written in the book, for those who are interested, what I think is an appropriate grand strategy for the United States in this coming period, and that would be helpful in terms of prioritization and sizing capabilities and what capabilities you need, and therefore resources that are needed. And also, I have to say that some of our institutions need reform, adaptation, and change, and that's not easy We could get a lot more for the money we spend on some of the things that we're spending money on, because our institutions are not as agile, as efficient, as effective, as kind of cooperative with each other in integration of different instruments to achieve results. So my experience is in two huge operations of the United States, Afghanistan and Iraq, has led me to believe that there's reform also needed. But I do believe that America has a unique role and responsibility even in terms of what happens in the world. And rather than this zigzagging of huge exertion and withdrawal, we need a grand strategy that can guide us that with a balanced approach in terms of the integration of the different instrument in the service of our objectives. And I'm sure that during the question and answer, we can talk more details about that.
And I think now we can take a couple questions from the audience to talk further.
Thank you, Jenna, Ambassador Khalilzad. Just to remind everyone, Ambassador Khalilzad will be available in the lobby to meet every one of you and autograph your book. But I'd like to first start Q&A by asking, you were in Iraq from 2005 to 2007 as our U.S. ambassador. Obviously, right now, the country is totally war-torn, very, very deep sectarian lines. What does a political solution ultimately look like in Iraq, ideally?
Well, what's happened in Iraq, as well as in Syria and the region at red large, is the result of a variety of problems that have deep roots and are also linked with the current geopolitical rivalry in the region. The deep root is one of Islamic civilizational crisis, I believe. Muslims believe, who are believers, that their religion, Islam, is the ultimate religion, the perfect religion, the last word of God, the last prophecy. It perfected all previous religions. And there is no, they don't believe, Muslims, that there is any religion prophecy after Muhammad. Muhammad was the seal of prophecy. And Islamic civilization, they believe, did very well, and that's historically true, early stages. It was on the march, it was prosperous, it was open, it was bringing Greek and Central Asian science and adding to it. Europe was down, the Islamic Empire was up, so to speak. Over time, the roles reversed. Remember I said at the beginning, you have to be careful, once you're at the top, doesn't mean you always stay at the top unless you do the right thing, so to speak. And this decline has created a crisis as to what went wrong and what should we do. And this had brought about divisions among Muslims as to what the right thing to do is and why we are doing poorly. That's one cause of the fight among Muslims, specifically in this area. Second is, not only they did poorly compared Muslims compared to foreigners, these foreigners came to their area and drew their borders for them and created states. The borders of Iraq, the borders of Syria are not borders that were created by the locals. It was the British and the French foreign offices that saying, you know, let's divide and the spoils of victory against the Ottoman Empire, and Syria went to France and Iraq went to Britain, and the Kurds were promised independence, then the last minute they were denied. And minorities were put in power in each of them. Another cause, root cause of the problems of the area. Then the governments are not performing that well, have not been performing that well. Another cause of the problem. And now what you have is that sectarianism has been added to the crisis of Islamic civilization. That is connected with the geopolitical rivalry between Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Turkey as the three main powers. who are looking for who is going to be the preeminent power of this region and is entangled with the Shia-Sunni problems. So my thinking has been that while we, the United States, should be very careful about getting entangled in some of these conflicts, because this could zap our energies and could be a cause of our decline, because that's why empires have declined at times. They have not known when to not to get involved, so to speak. When you see a vacuum, it doesn't mean necessarily you have to be the one to fill it. And that we should, on the other hand, defend ourselves against specific threats against the United States. But we should work for one of the big signs that Nixon, where President Nixon is buried, it says the blessed are the peacemakers, so to speak. As to how we should encourage a kind of neo-Westphalia, for those of you buffs of history, is the Catholic-Protestant wars of Europe, to get the Turks, Saudis, and Iranians to accept Shiism and Sunnism as equally legitimate religions or sects of Islam, we will have a catalytic role. We are not going to be a big role in this regard. But to have a balance of power arrangements and diplomacy that they can have some rules and regulations about the competition. Without that, I believe Iraq will not be stabilized, where the Shia, Sunni, and Kurds are going to have a role that they would be satisfied with if their sponsors, neighboring states, want to use them for their own purposes for the fight in that area. It may take some federal or confederal arrangements, too, until trust is rebuilt among these communities. But I think the fate of these countries now is linked to the broader struggle between the big boys or the big powers of the region, and the goal of our diplomacy should be to encourage some sort of an agreement. And we should have relations with all of those powers. I think we should be opposing Iranian hostile acts. We should be open to engagement and to talking with them, and we shouldn't shy away from engagement. And I've been recently writing and advocating that we need to have good relations with not only our traditional allies, but also be open to engagement with Iran, because for the solution that is needed for the region, Iran has a big role to play, and therefore we need to be able to engage them as well.
We have a question in the back row from a student at the University of Southern California.
Mr. Ambassador, I've been wondering about the war on terror and how it will eventually end. So there's an argument that a lot of terrorism springs from the social crisis in the Arab world nowadays, and the reason why young men are driven to ideological extremes is because of the socioeconomic conditions that have been going on in the Middle East for quite some time. And it would seem that to alleviate that, to go to the root of the problem of the social crisis in the Muslim world, you would have to do what otherwise is known as nation building. But we know there's no appetite for that nowadays after two decades of war. So my question for you is, absent a commitment to nation building, which we don't even know that it would work if we tried it again, does this imply that we're stuck with an Islamist world that will continue to have the terrorism problem going on for decades on end? And if so, are we condemned to be fighting the kind of miniature colonial wars that we're fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan and to other degrees in Yemen and Libya and Syria for the rest of this century even?
Sure. Very good question. I believe that the war against terrorism in its entirety cannot be one, although I thought about it for a minute, because what do we mean by winning in this case, but it will not end, let's say, the terrorism from that region, from the that is the product of the Islamic civilization's crisis that I talked about and the associated factors, will not end until the crisis ends. And I give you one roadmap for the crisis. While during the different phases, because we are far from getting to that answer that I described as the as what would be needed, that we would have to be prepared to smartly defend ourselves, protect ourselves, harden ourselves against potential threats, and go after selectively and precisely against those targets. But I think this current hostility that we have in our body politic about state and nation building, you may be right, I'm sure you're right, that our leaders are saying we don't have the stomach for state and nation building. But part of the answer to the terrorism problem is to help, not for us to build, but for us to help build state and nations. Because if we don't want terrorists to attack us, let's say from Afghanistan, the example that I gave, the territory of Afghanistan has to be controlled by friendly forces. Who are the friendly forces? Either it's us, we're obviously friendly to ourselves, so we have to police it. That's very expensive. Or we have to help in cooperation with allies to develop local forces to control that territory. In other words, sometimes we have to do state and nation building to solve a strategic problem. Or we have to be to say we have to, we will live with the strategic problem. We want to solve it. And we have had a history of success also in state and nation building. We shouldn't look to the examples of Iraq. But when we look at even at Iraq, we have to learn the right lessons. In Afghanistan, for example, we had 100,000+ troops at one point. Now we have less than 10,000. The Afghan forces that we have helped build are doing the fighting mostly. We are helping here and there with air power. You've seen it's not much in the news that we should get out of Afghanistan lately. At least I don't see it, because there are no American casualties every day talked about, because we're not doing a lot of combat operations. And I think if we can demonstrate that with a minimal level of effort, we can help them police their territory from which we won't get attacked, it may be comparatively better than the alternative. I have a crude example, a way of thinking about this. There is the problem of mosquitoes and the swamp. Now, as long as the swamp is there, mosquitoes will be produced. We can use particular means to kill the mosquitoes. There are a variety of options, as you know. But we could be doing this forever. Or if we want to deal with it in a strategic and an enduring way, we have to dry the swamp, and that's the problem that we have here.
Question to your left.
What are your thoughts on the Iranian nuclear deal?
Of course, I think I'm such a good diplomat that if I had to negotiate it, I would have gotten us a better deal. I think that the deal has some issues, some problems, but I think it would be a mistake to throw it away. I believe that we ought to keep the deal and try to replicate similar arrangements on the missiles and other things that worry us about Iran. But at the same time, I am of the view that we should be open to engagement with them. I'm an advocate of staffing our interest section in the Swiss embassy in Tehran with American diplomats and allow Iranians to have diplomats in the Pakistani embassy that represents Iranian interests in Washington. I believe that we should engage with them on regional issues that are of concern, but at the same time, I believe that we ought to oppose them when they pursue hostile policies regionally, and that we should speak up against their abuses of human rights in Iran. Sometimes I worry that because of the nuclear deal, we are constraining ourselves, thinking that if we do oppose them on regional issues or speak forcefully on their abuse of their own people, maybe the nuclear deal will be at risk. I think the test of a good deal is that the deal is a deal, it's a transaction on a particular issue, but we ought to be equally committed to opposing hostile regional policies by them and speaking on the on their human rights abuses.
Question right here.
It's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, sir.
Now, my personal experience growing up in Afghanistan was a little different. It was filled with, although it was great, it was clouded by war and terror and all of that. So having that personal experience for me, looking at the TV, the media, and knowing from family members over there, there's still, it's been a war-torn country for many years, and where do you see it changing? Where do you see the U.S.'s further involvement in the country? And I have hope for the country. I want to know what your thoughts are.
Sure. Well, Afghanistan has had a long history of peace and stability too. From 1930 to 1978, it was a relatively peaceful country. The Soviet invasion started the unraveling of the state. And then it has continued with the, what I described earlier. Part of the answer to Afghanistan's stability is what I talked about in the case of Syria and Iraq, the regional diplomacy being so important. In Afghanistan, too, regional diplomacy is important. The mother of Afghanistan's recent instability problem, in my judgment, has been the policies of Pakistan, which has allowed a sanctuary for the Taliban to emerge in Pakistan. And I believe that in the aftermath of 9/11, when we had the attention of the world during that golden hour, we should have been much more proactive in terms of our diplomacy to get an agreement between Afghanistan and Pakistan that precluded the Taliban from having sanctuaries in Pakistan, the Khani network in Pakistan. From those bases, that they attack Afghanistan, come across and attack. Without that, the options for the Afghans is obviously to harden themselves to resist until Pakistan changes its calculus. And for us, unfortunately, either we redouble our effort to get an arrangement between these two countries that avoids the sanctuaries remaining and destabilizing Afghanistan, or assisting Afghanistan to be able to resist until the calculus of Pakistan changes, or abandoning Afghanistan. And then we go back to a Taliban, Al-Qaeda takeover of the country again and posing a threat. So we don't have good options in the face of the sanctuary problem that exists in Pakistan. So a regional settlement is important in Afghanistan as well as it is, as I said before, important in the case of Iraq and Syria.
We have a question in the back row.
I have a question about the Afghan government going forward. Is it possible for a stable government to form with the opium trade and the amount of money that comes into the government through corrupt sources?
Well, thank you. That's an excellent question. The government of Afghanistan doesn't tax opium. So what opium does is it's criminalized the economy of the country. And it may be a factor in why Pakistan is allowing sanctuaries to develop in the following way. That there is a lot of money with opium and heroin trade. There is money being made by allowing the trafficking to occur, for the traffickers to cross areas, and particular warlords in Afghanistan or leaders can make money from it. Afghanistan is a landlocked country. It can't get to the world without going through another country that is connected to the world more through seaports or through land borders. And there's no question that some of that opium and heroin goes through Pakistan. And some go through Central Asia, and some go even through Iran. And the Iranians have had their own serious problem. And when you have a stable situation, a stable government, an authoritative government that can control territory and police the territory, and you outlaw production of heroin and you outlaw opium production on large scale, you can enforce that, perhaps, than if you had a state of conflict where there is no rule of law. Many of us students of strategy and strategic thinking always look for geopolitical reasons for why countries behave in the way they do. But countries are made of, their leadership made of individuals. And sometimes we don't pay enough attention as students of strategy to more mundane interests, such as who's making money from this ongoing conflict. How much money is some Pakistani institutions, such as the military intelligence of Pakistan, ISI, is making from the heroin trade? Is Pakistan allowing sanctuaries because of some geopolitical grand strategy? Or is it doing it because there are some officers who make money from this deal? I'm not in a position to say it is one or the other. I'm not alleging that. But certainly, in terms of financing not only criminal elements but terrorist elements, heroin and opium is a factor. How much of the Taliban money is money coming from heroin? That's why building the state institutions or having friendly forces control territory is important, because that in turn could affect and the production. Now, there is an alternative thinking, as you know, that as long as there is demand, somebody will produce these things. The most you can do is to push them out of one area into another area. I mean, there was a time that Southeast Asia was where the production occurred. Pakistan was where the production occurred. And now it's in Afghanistan, and you know, there are proposals for legalizing. But that's a different debate than a national security debate.
We have a question to your right.
Hello. It seems as if the Saudi role is changing. And what do you see as the role of Saudi Arabia in the future in the Middle East? And do you think that will contribute to stability or not stability?
Let me repeat, ma'am, if I understood your question. You're asking about the role of Saudi Arabia, right? Would it be positive force for stability or a negative force?
Well, I don't know. It just seems
that's
that,
the question, right?
That's the question.
Yes, sure. No,
I
wanted to. Thank you. Well, as you heard me say, that Saudi Arabia is one of the three pillars, key players in that region. Right now, the Saudis are profoundly concerned about Iran, their rivalry with Iran. And for them, stopping Iran is the most important issue. And they even are willing to support more Sunni extremist groups who oppose Iran. And that's where we differ with them, the United States, with Saudi Arabia. For us, opposing the extremist groups is the most important issue. And for them, stopping Iran is the most important issue. And they feel that we are not as strong against Iran, and that there is a growing gap between our kind of policies and theirs. Now, Saudi Arabia faces a lot of internal challenges. I'm not in a position to judge whether it will become, over what time frame, more unstable because of these internal tensions within the family, the royal family, between the reformist elements within the family and outside, and their religious Wahhabi establishment, which is a very hard line, anti-Shia, anti-reform. But certainly, when you think about the region, one of the countries whose policies and whose future would have a huge effect is Saudi Arabia. As I mentioned before, the other two being Turkey and Iran.
We have a question right in the center.
Hi, thank you for sharing. Part of it got answered. People were talking about nation building, so on and so forth. I'm a big student of history and philosophy, probably not on the level you are. But to me, it seems, for many years, I've always found it kind of funny that the Western diplomats want to try and negotiate deals with what I consider to be, based on history and philosophy, read John Locke or Montesquieu, in the civil society, that we have a true clash of cultures, and that you cannot nation build a society similar to ours, a civil society, with people that have 5,000 years of basically tribal violence on each other and totalitarian systems within their own family, their neighborhoods, and their societies. I don't know the answer. And you kind of touched on it, talking about maybe all you can do is protect yourself and contain. But I'd just like to your take on that. You know, you started off on that, talking about the different factions over there and so on and so forth. And that's odds for 30, 40 years has mystified me, that the Western world tries to negotiate with, you know, a Saddam Hussein or whatever, who'll say whatever in the room and walk out and do whatever they're exactly going to do, because they are morally different than us, I believe.
It's a good point. I think it's a point that's very much on the minds of many people, what you're reflecting. But I have a slightly different perspective, respectfully, and that is that if we look at the history of the world, and even our own interaction with the world in different times, we have said that certain things and certain cultures do not go together. We have assumed that. And it turns out that we were wrong in that assumption. Many people during the period of post-World War II, when talked about building a democratic Japan, thought, what? Democracy in Japan and the Japanese imperial tradition do not go together. This is kind of a Western, silliness to think that, a lack of seriousness, and yet it happened. Many believed after World War II that Germans and democracy did not go together. And when India was becoming independent, and people thought that democracy in India would not work. They're a different culture, different history. I think we, having said that, of course, the democracy has its requirements. It takes time. In some places, it easily find roots. In other places, it's harder to build its roots. And it's not an easy system, but it's better than the alternatives. So I believe that while I don't believe that we should go around and impose our system on others, no, that's not what I favor. But what I was talking about, state and nation building, I was talking about if you have a strategic problem which needs the control of a piece of territory to solve it, what options do you have? If you either we control that territory or we have built friendly forces to control that territory. I think on balance, having local forces that are friendly control the territory is cheaper and has a more enduring solution than continuously going and bombing for indefinitely. So that's those are the alternatives that we have. Imagine if we hadn't done state building in Korea. Korea is quite different than the West, and yet now it's a very prosperous, democratic. We still have forces there, and we don't even discuss it as much anymore as at time we used to discuss. Now we are saying maybe they should get nuclear weapons. Some are saying this, so that they we don't have to be there at all. But I just think that our options are such that if we have to make a choice, I prefer this choice of helping local forces. I'm not a supporter of non-strategic nation build and state building. I think I wasn't an advocate of nation building in Somalia, and I have nothing against Somalia. We didn't have a strategic problem to solve. If once we say that, then what are our alternatives? And I think on balance, this is a better alternative. The question that we should be studying or debating where should we do it under what circumstances and how smartly we should do, what lessons should we learn from the mistakes that we have made. Imagine today, I give you two examples and whether we would go in and do state or nation building or not. Assume today Damascus is taken over by ISIS. What are we going to do about that? Are we going to say, well, we're going to bomb them, yeah? So ultimately, what are you going to do? Are you going to evict them from Damascus? You're going to defeat them, take over Damascus, and do what with it? Or if the 10 million barrels of oil that is produced in eastern Saudi Arabia is taken over by ISIS, what are we going to do in those scenarios? And I think on balance, we are likely to come to a view that we need to have friendly forces that we, with our help, can help solve the strategic problem that only by control of that territory by friendly forces can produce.
Thank you, Ambassador Khalilzad. Jaina, please give them both a round of applause.